it has a lot of rationality around it. But the core essence of a Sikh is not based on a rational acceptance of the Guru, but it's based on the love of the Guru. And the Guru actually puts that in his own words. He said, listen everybody, I speak the truth. Only those who love will find God. So the Guru becomes a person before in love.
I don't.
We've got a lot of history of this.
I empathize with that.
The religion is not that old. Yeah, you can say 1,000 years ago, 2,200 years ago. And within that 200 years, we've got all this philosophy, teachings, the actual places they live, what they said, what they did, their own writings. So with the Guru, historically, we're quite blessed in that sense. But we know they were around. They weren't just somebody made it up. We know what they wrote. We know what they did. We've got people, families, and generations that are still now linked to the Guru lineage who are around. So historically we're blessed, and then obviously spiritually they're very blessed.
So it seems to me that the answer to my question that I need some kind of rational grounding still is
still
contingent on an emotional, in an emotional spiritual thing,
well,
right?
No,
an experiential. But you said that it's love, isn't it? Love, trusting him because it's through love, in understanding his teachings, internalizing his teachings. I'm not dismissing, I find that very profound, don't get me wrong. I think for it to be slightly more holistic, and it's one of the reasons why I became Muslim is because not only do you have what you call the nafsiya, the internal psychological disposition, the spirituality, the ethics, the rules and stuff like that, the experiences, but you also have it grounded in a rational tradition.
Okay.
And I find that powerful.
I think the thing here is...
Does that make sense to you?
Yeah, I'll just explain. I've watched nearly all your videos to the rational arguments for God and found them lacking.
Yes,
so that's my personal view. It's not going to be offensive to you. I just give you And the thing is I think that you've got some standard inside you that's trying to say it's got to be rational. But that rational standard doesn't really even stand up. Your own arguments don't stand up. So here's my view.
Why do you think that's okay?
Because I watched your videos and didn't really make me believe in God. If I was an atheist, I wouldn't believe in God based on those arguments.
Absolutely.
So I don't think that you can argue that you've got a rational viewpoint that can convince
you. I totally appreciate what you're saying.
A lot of people who watch your videos and don't believe the comments.
Yeah, of course.
So when you say rational, it seems to imply transferability to everybody. That it must be something so rational most rational people would agree with it.
Okay.
But I don't think that's
let me give you the premise here, right? We believe in the fitrah and the natural disposition that we know God exists and He deserves to be worshipped. This is the natural disposition, right? We have this we have this innate nature, yeah? This natural disposition that we appreciate the oneness of God, we appreciate that God deserves to be worshipped, right? Now this is the fitrah, it's called the innate disposition. Imagine it like a glass.
Well, we talked about this earlier.
Yeah,
that's not a new point.
Yeah, but I want to bring it to this point.
Okay.
And what we say is, if this glass is clouded or dirty, it requires cleaning.
Yeah.
Cleaning can include rational arguments, can include the Quran, the Sunnah, spiritual teachings, ethics, experiences, right? So it cleans the fitrah.
What's new in there?
Yeah, exactly. No. What's new is, you've assumed that I'm using the argument as an end, not a means. Arguments are a means just to clean the fitrah.
Right.
And what I wanted to take up upon, I totally appreciate you have an opinion on what old debates or whatever rubbish I used to talk about, right? But the point is, it is a claim. My question was, why aren't they coherent enough for you? That was my view, that was my point. But that's going to go to another topic, which is irrelevant.
That's kind of like you're judging me now on my rationality and logic.
No, I'm saying you said that they weren't rational enough, and I'm just asking
why. I'm just saying about your standard, because what you said to me now is very similar to what I would say to any Sikh. Say, if you want to get into Sikhi and you like what the Gurus are teaching, then go into the Gurdwara, listen to explanations of the scripture, sit in the holy congregation, chant God's name. What that will do is slowly wash your soul, what we were talking about earlier, and allow that light inside to come out and have an experience.
I agree, we have some.
And when that experience happens, then you have a real faith, because it's based upon the experience of God. Before that, you've still got doubt because you're not quite sure. When that experience happens to you, that's it. You know, it's happening to you right now. It ties in with what every single of the 36 people that wrote in Guru Granth Sahib Ji have also said. So it ties in. It's not just the Gurus, it's the people that weren't even the Gurus, like Ram, Kabir Ji and Ramana.
Yeah.
These people, it ties in with them.
Yeah.
So then it gives you a sort of external confirmation that it's not just the Gurus, it's everybody else who's also, some people before the Gurus, like Sheikh Fareed is before the Gurus, other people are after the Gurus, so not after the Gurus, but obviously they're the Gurus' time.
Yeah.
And it can also tie in with the people that have since then lived as Sikhs, earned the Sikh teachings, and experienced the same divine. So it becomes, and it ties in with mystics across the world.
Yeah, sure.
So, you know, the mystical tradition is not just a Sikh tradition. It's in the Sufi, Sikhis that we have our brothers and it's in the Sufis, it's in the Christians, it's all over the world. So what we're talking about is that looking at the world as a whole, it gives you that, you know what, I'm not just having a crazy experience that I can't, that no one else has had before. This is an experience that has happened to loads of people of different traditions, and they all walk the same path, which to me is very rational to accept that as an argument for this, that you're not having a crazy experience, and the Guru is giving you really
crazy. I would disagree with that. Here, why? Because if we just solely rely on the spiritual aspect, and we solely rely on the spiritual aspect.
That is God.
Yeah, but
you can't just say, just don't rely upon God to believe in God.
Yeah, no.
Believe in something else.
No, but the point is,
God is God. God
but
is
you really have a standard of God and you're trying to fit your experience to
No, I don't have a standard of God. I've got experience of God. I'm not talking about a standard of God. I'm just saying, the experience of God.
You're saying it's God, and then you have an experience and it reaffirms God. So you're starting with
the
idea of God.
Yeah, the Guru's teaching.
Yeah.
Taught by the Guru.
Yeah.
And then you put them into practice. He's like an instructor.
Yeah.
Right? The word Guru actually is based into the idea of an instructor. So he's got people
that... I appreciate that you mentioned that before.
So it doesn't really make much sense to say to me, I don't think it's fair that you believe in your gym teacher, because now after his teachings you've become fit and strong and now you've got faith in him. That's not fair. You looked at him first, you saw that he was fit. That's biased you towards trying his way, and now you've tried it and you become fit and strong, and now you've got faith in him. That means that you decided what was fit first.
Have you decided philosophy?
You do know that.
I did this for a postgrad, right? And then what you would understand is that just because something works, it doesn't mean it's true.
Yeah.
So you have to appreciate that.
No, I agree.
So your whole premise.
And then I gave you the other idea about the confirmation of all the different faiths and understand that what you're going through is not just a Sikh thing, it's just mystics across the world.
Yeah, that's fine. That's if you believe that's grounded in some kind of rational truth. The point is, you have to understand that just because something works, it doesn't mean it's true. Like in the scientific method, for example, they had this theory called phlogiston. Phlogiston, it was in the 1700s. Now phlogiston was very interesting because they said that any combustible object that burnt, it would release phlogisticated air. Now that was a workable theory in the 1700s that chemists used, and Dan Rutherford in 1772 or 1773, he basically used that theory to discover nitrogen, discovered the truth. But then they find out later that theory of phlogiston was false. So this one example of many, then philosophy of science, just because something works, it doesn't mean it's true. Likewise, in spirituality, just because something works, it doesn't mean it's true. And that's why I want you to find out what Sikhism is about, because everything you've said really, for me, and please correct me if I'm wrong, can be reduced to just an experiential thing, which is fine. It's very needed, don't get me wrong. Islam is very important.
Can I answer the point now? I understood the point. I don't need any more explanation. So,
let me talk as well though, yeah?
No, you spoke for quite a while. But here's the point, right?
You get that point what I'm saying?
When you say, yeah, I do understand. I'll explain to you how I understand that it's true. When I was studying philosophy at university, one of the things we talked about was actually this idea of experiential. How do you know what's true? So one of the arguments we make is, well, the color purple, right, is a subjective thing. It's not necessarily objective, right?
Yeah.
So one of the problems with
the experience of
color, the experience of color, experience of anything,
absolutely.
Most things are purely subjective. You can't objectify them. So how they decide to go beyond this kind of Descartes philosophy where you're, not Descartes, but kind of like you're living in your own, Tzortzis, I think it's called.
Yes, Tzortzis.
They're just living their own world and nothing else makes sense. Is they then, Descartes trying to get to it through God. We try to get through it just by trying to think of it like logic, yeah? Like, even if I spend all day thinking, I can't prove that's purple. When I go home, I say to my wife, do you like this purple top? She knows it's purple, I know it's purple, everybody around me knows purple. If I spend my whole day working out, can I know it's purple or not? Maybe it's a different purple. I'm going to be basically wasting my time because it's kind of idiocy. Right? I said earlier, it's like if you assume that people are idiots, then yeah, they can't do that. But people aren't idiots, yeah? Because God hasn't made us to be idiots, because God's, you know, the creator. So, taking that argument, when color is subjective, in the same way you might say, well, actually, color may be subjective, but really, it's quite objective, and most people wouldn't agree upon it. So you can generalize, otherwise you couldn't really live or survive.
Yeah, for something that's...
So, in the same way, when I said to you earlier, when you have that experience of God, okay,
it's the same as the color purple.
A is backed up by what the Guru is saying.
Yeah.
B is backed up by all the other people inside the Guru Granth Sahib that are not even Sikh. From the Sikh background.
But why is what the Guru saying is true? That was my question from the beginning.
The point of it being true is that it works.
Yeah, but now, what works doesn't mean it's true.
No, but the fact that it works and it's worked consistently for different people of different faiths, different backgrounds, and the Gurus, and that they say that...
Just like phlogiston, bro. It worked and it came out to be false.
No. The point here is that...
Newton's laws work, but they're not absolutely true.
Here's the thing. until someone can.
Do you see my point?
And so until someone can disprove that the experience I'm having, what the gurus are saying, is not true, right? I'm entitled to believe. That
okay,
it
there's
is
two
true,
ways to disprove right? your experience firstly, hypothetically. Number one, with another experience, or number, and that just becomes subjective. Or number two, by some external criteria, like reason or rationality.
Yeah, but that external criteria that you gave earlier about why you think rationally Islam is true.
I didn't give any criteria. Really, I didn't give any
no,
criteria.
No, but you've done it online too many times in arguments.
Yeah, but let's be fair, bro.
And to be honest, not really
let's be fair. Let's be fair.
Okay, fair enough.
Let's,
no, let's be fair. Stuff, hey,
let me just tell you something. This is nasiha, advice to you, right? Never in a conversation with someone refer to the old work, especially when you're not even saying what is wrong about it. That's a bit unfair.
Nope.
And I would say not part of the ethics of discussion. I could say to you, bro, I saw a video of you, you talked about Abdurrahim Green 2 years ago in a video, and you know what, you're slightly incoherent here. I think it's bad adab, bro. Yeah, but you haven't even said what was wrong with it. That's my point. You just keep on saying it's wrong, you're not saying why it's wrong.
I did say to you why I thought it was wrong, because it didn't, as a rational person, convince me that there is a problem.
No, that's not a statement, it's a claim. You need to tell me why that, like, why is that claim true?
No, but surely, when you're saying
you see what I'm trying
rationality,
to say here?
You're pointing to an idea that someone who's rational listens to you and then goes, yeah, it's true. I'll give you an example.
Yeah.
I do a physics experiment. You know, I throw a ball off a cliff, it falls down, I have a camera that measures its speed, and then I say to people, well, I use this camera to measure the speed, and the ball fell at this speed. Every rational person would buy that.
Mm.
Only an irrational person would say no. So the arguments you present here, I don't have to go to specifics of each one. What I can say is, rationally, you haven't worked. And the proof of that is not just me, is that many people have watched your work, who are rational people, and not bought it.
I'm going to hold on to you
but,
right
but,
now.
But let me give you the opposite.
You're still not
let
saying
me
give why.
Opposite. Many people...
But many people have become Muslim.
Let me finish.
Many people have found them rational.
True, but the other thing is...
So how is, many what, people you, how is your
here's,
claim...
Here's my argument.
Has it
many
validated?
People have understood this rationality argument I'm talking about, that the experience is not just subjective. By taking the idea of colour, you can take the objectivity, apply it across the board, and look at other people of different faces and backgrounds, actually say, oh, you know what, this makes a lot of sense. It's actually the truth. And it's not just purely...
My friend.
But listen, here's the point. I haven't met a single person who's experienced the divine in the way that we just talked about. I met a guy earlier who was a... I don't know what he was.
Well, you've met me.
Oh, anyway. But I don't know if you've had that experience. We haven't talked about that experience and what you've experienced.
Yeah, of course.
But this guy talked about his experience of God, and I talked about
there's
my experience.
There's millions of people.
The point is, when he was agreeing with everything I'm talking about, because rationally it made sense to him.
Okay.
But the rationality comes from that lens of that spirituality.
Sure.
Any rationality,
I'm not denying that.
For me, I'm
not with
really
you 100% on the spirituality issue, right? When I'm trying to deconstruct...
Like the Sufi brothers.
Yeah.
They're spiritual.
Absolutely.
They agree with us.
Absolutely.
Right? So...
Well, I don't disagree with you about the innate nature and about spirituality and ethics and connecting with the divine. I'm with you here, right?
Yeah.
My only issue is the how you connect with the divine according to your tradition. Because you said you can't equate the experience of purple and knowing it's purple with a tradition that requires a whole set of teachings and experiences to understand its truth. Because purple you understand without any of those...
Losing you.
Okay.
But I don't know if you're going too philosophical, but
okay.
It's hard to
okay.
understand.
Is this blue?
Yes.
This is yellow?
Yes.
Good, this is the beautiful beard, right?
MashaAllah.
So you got beautiful beard. So we know it's a beard, it's blue and it's yellow.
Yeah.
I don't need a set of intermediary experiences to understand that.
Yeah.
I don't need a whole philosophy, a theology to understand that, right? So it's you're falsely equating two things here. You can't equate, let me explain that. You can't equate the feeling of purple, the understanding that those are white trainers,
yeah,
with the fact that the Buddhist teachings are absolutely true. Because you've been told, you've just said before, you need a bunch of experiences, you need the Buddhist teachings. So for me, you can't equate those two things
okay,
as the
okay,
same.
Okay,
does that make sense?
Okay. I said to you earlier.
I'm telling you, for me, I'm just saying a lot of the things that you're saying are nice, they're
let's
fluffy,
say,
but they're very incoherent.
Okay, no, they're not. I'll explain to you.
Yeah, sure.
You could be sitting in a dark room and you don't know about colors.
Yes.
Right? Because, like I said to you earlier, God is not something that.
It's like the Frank Jackson experiment.
I don't know who that guy is, but I'm making it up on the spot, right? So
you said you studied philosophy.
Yeah,
so.
But I don't know who that guy is.
Okay, cool.
Do you understand that?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's get back to that. So we're sitting in a dark room, because like Plato was talking about the people in the cave, they don't
absolutely
know the truth.
Yeah.
So most people are unaware of God, most people are totally separate from God.
Yes, yes.
So a person separate from God is very similar to someone sitting in a dark room.
Okay.
Right?
Yes.
Now, when they're in this dark room, you're trying to explain to them colour.
Yeah.
They're like, so black and everything.
They have to experience colour.
Yeah. So the person says, you can give me all this philosophy, mate, But I'm not going to believe in it until I see color, right? That doesn't mean that person is wrong for having trusted you that there is color, because you've just come in from outside and told them all that. They might have a doubt in your mind, in their mind, that, oh, is there color or not? Is this guy just pulling it? You know, on me, it's always been dark, but I've been around. But they said, you know what? I'll give you proof. Why don't you hold my hand, come with me through that door, and I'll take you into color. Now you see color. Now, it would not be fair to say that person is irrational to choose to follow that person.
Agreed.
It wouldn't be irrational. It would be a rational thing to say, you know what, why not try it? If that person, you've known them for a long time, they looked after you, they took care of you, they were very trustworthy, you would say, let's go for it, let's try. And then you go outside and voila, you see color. And not only do you see color, you see a whole bunch of other people walking around who also see color.
Sure.
And they all agree that that is purple, and that is a yellow jumper, and that's a blue hoodie, and that's a nice beard.
Yes.
They all agree with you. So suddenly you think, hallelujah, it must be true. And that would not be an irrational person.
No, I agree.
Well, there we go.
But that's a solid experience.
And what we're talking about at the beginning, right?
Well, no, but you just said something else. What? You have to remind me what you said. You said you've experienced any of the guru's teachings. So coming back to my original question that you tried to answer was, how do you rationally ground the guru's teachings? Could you separate guru's teachings
from experience? You know, you've got that weird argument, the 40...
No.
Are we doing some circular kind of thing going on here?
No.
It feels like we're just going round and round.
Allow the ad hominems there. Yeah. I'm not cussing you. Allow the cusses, right? Let's keep the ad hominem.
No, but...
You're known to be a nice guy.
I'm trying to be nice.
And a bad guy like me, I don't want to shame you. I'm supposed to be the bad guy,
I'm
right?
I'm not a nice guy. But
you are a nice guy.
I'm trying.
What I'm trying to say to you is...
I'm trying to listen to you.
Did you...
But I just explained something I thought made sense to most people. But you've just gone back and said it doesn't make sense.
No, I just said it makes sense. No, it makes sense, but I'm trying to see how it makes sense within everything that you've said. So what you're saying is...
You agree that guy was rational?
He's rational to a degree, but
right.
I'm the guy in the dark.
Okay,
but if that guy told you, therefore, there is no gravity after that, you're not going to trust him, right?
True, but the good doesn't say anything lies to me.
But that's my point. My point is, for someone who doesn't accept Islam, right, is someone, he may know what colors look like, but it's like taking the guy at the dark room saying that's purple, and then the guy's trusting him because saying it's purple, but then it's saying, look at the horizon, the earth is flat. So just because I'm trusting...
Just because someone doesn't believe in Islam, then you're saying they're equivalent to somebody who could get told a lie later on, but they're not sure, it could never work out.
No, it's true. Sorry, you misunderstood what I'm saying. What I'm trying to say is, you can trust someone. If you're in a dark room of your life and they're taking it out, said, look at colour, and this is the colour purple,
and
you
worked.
Can trust them.
But you can't just trust that one
can
person.
You
it's that what I talked about earlier, the rational element. It's not just
yes, but
person.
Then can you trust him if he tells you something that is irrational? That's my point.
It's a good question. The question,
and that's what I've been trying to get at all along. Because you distinguish between the experiences and the guru's teachings.
Let me go into something.
You remember that 70-30% thing that you mentioned about?
Okay.
And I've asked, can you ground the guru's teachings as evidence? And you can't rely on experiences because you've disconnected them. So therefore, what is the evidence for the guru's teachings? And you've spent quite a long time not doing that. People talk about experiences, which is a secular argument.
Let's say, for example, somebody comes into Sikhism who's not from a Sikh background or an Indian background.
Yeah.
So they're white. They come in, they meditate, it's like experience God, right? And they believe in the guru's experience about God. They buy that. They're cool. But then they've never heard about reincarnation, and they've got this philosophy, they think, I don't know if I can believe this philosophy. I have no proof of this and whatever, right? So fair enough. Now, the guru says that Sikhi is about enlightenment. So it's not just one door when you open and you see colour. There's a whole bunch of other things that are going to happen afterwards as you go through more and more doors of enlightenment. A bit like...
And how do you know that's true? Though?
Let me just explain. As you go through the cave analogy, right? You're coming out and out, and you're expanding your horizons and your doors of perception.
Yeah.
So, initially you might say, well, I'm not sure if reincarnation is true. However, based on what the Guru's told me so far, and I haven't experienced it, but I believe what he said so far, and I believe in the morals of the Guru so far. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to reserve judgment on whether it's true or not. I'm going to trust the Guru. But the Guru does say it's possible for you to keep growing spiritually to the point where you can experience your previous life. When you have that experience of your previous life, voila. Now, you not only listen to it, followed it, but you've actually now accepted it to be true because you've seen it to be true.
Little experiences, basically.
Right, because but the whole of Sikhi is about spirituality.
Sure.
Because at one point, the soul goes from somebody who's in a dark room to being somebody being totally one with God.
I've got it.
Totally one with God.
It's a very enlightening conversation.
It's all about growth.
So, this is where maybe the subtle difference between Sikhism and Islam comes into play, right? Where Islam, from that point of view, has the whole concept of the fitrah, the innate disposition, ibadah, worship, which means to love God, to know God, to obey God, and to single all acts of worship to Him alone. We have this kind of profound kind of philosophy, if you like, of this idea, concept, reality of the oneness of God, affirming His oneness, tawheed, in His name and attributes, in His singularity.
You gotta give me some differences so far.
I'm connecting with you. So, I think the difference is here is that regard, like, no matter where you go with your experiences, there's always going to be this very base grounding. Call it rationality, call it innate truth.
What is that?
I'm going to tell you what it is. I don't want to say that. What I'm saying is that we would say Tawheed, the conceptualization of the divine, as per the Islamic tradition, is that foundation. So your experiences are seen through them. Because, for example, someone came up to me, a Christian, he said, I had a dream of Jesus, right? Yeah. And a Jew could come up to me and say, I had a dream of Moses. Yeah. And a Buddhist said, I had a dream of Buddha. Yeah. Now, as a human being, I'm not going to deny his experiences. I mean, that's evil, right? Because you deny them. You deny your relationship now, right? Yeah. What I do, though, and I try doing it in the most compassionate way, I say, look, the way to really understand your experiences is to understand the filter, the lenses that you use to see your experiences, right? So what I do then, I go to those filters and lenses. And that's very critical, because many people have different experiences, but they have different truths. Yeah. And that's fundamental, right?
So how do you reconcile that? You yourself.
So what
you got
I would say,
a guy who's saying, I've met, I had Buddha, other guys saying, I had met Jesus, and then met Moses. How do you, as an individual,
I would just teach him.
Actually, in your heart, I'll ask a simple question. Yeah. In your heart, do you think that the dream was purely in their mind, but there's no other link to it? There's
no
external.
We believe that, you know,
do you believe Buddha is around?
There are three types of dreams. There are three types of dreams, for example. One type of dream is from the divine, one is based on musings and thoughts, and one is from basically the kind of negative realm, the satanic realities, right? Yeah, shaitan. So from that point of view, we do appreciate that dreams have a basis, but what I'm saying here is, how do you get them to see the experiences via the lenses of truth? And
well,
that's
it?
Really
you've
important.
You've already decided.
Exactly. But then
I've got a lens of truth as well for me, the guru. So I would. No, I'm asking you now.
No, you're missing the point. Let me finish my point.
A simple question. Tell me how you see it.
Let me finish my point. I'll answer your question. My point here is, since you understand that you have experiences and you can filter them through different lenses, what you've solely given to me at the moment is just experiences, right? You haven't showed to me why your filters or lenses are true. And that's my point. Because I could talk about any form of spirituality and make it coherent because it's within that paradigm. What I'm saying to you, let's step out of the paradigm, right? We have certain lenses that you're viewing your narratives, your spiritual discourse, whatever you want to call it. And I'm saying what Islam does for me, and obviously we probably can't discuss this today, it takes a long time, that it gives me those filters. That's my point.
Are you chosen a filter that makes sense to you on rationality?
Absolutely.
But that's the personal thing. There's often the case that two people can sit in a situation,
have the same. But I just mentioned this to show the difference between Islam and Sikhism.
I'm just giving you a simple point. Two people can sit there, have the same rushed argument. One could agree, one could disagree.
Absolutely.
Right? So in which case, it's still subjective. So I don't know why you're so excited about that rationality being separate from the different constructs that already exist, the lenses.
Okay, there are two levels.
Because effectively, what you just said, and you agreed with me a minute ago, is that ultimately it all comes back to subjectivism.
No, there are a few levels here. For example, I exist, right? Yeah. And you exist.
But it wouldn't always exist.
Agreed, but we exist at the moment, so there's some foundational truths that we agree on.
Yeah.
But if I said to you, what's your idea on, for example, panspermia? You'd be like, what is that? Exactly. But that has its own coherent argument via a scientific explanation. It might not have any empirical evidence, but it's an argument that's coherent. And you don't have to accept that, but it's still based on some rational criteria. Yeah. Although we still agree on the rational basis of me and you existing, you still may not disagree with other rational truths. So it's not like, let's throw the baby out with the bathwater. So what I'm talking about is some foundational truths. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does make sense. But there's a big hole, I feel, in this whole thing, the elephant we're ignoring.
Sure.
That I'm not trying to give something objective to anyone,
sure,
to say that this is the objective way you can now totally prove it.
So you're saying
anybody.
So your answer to my original question was there's no objectivity behind the guru.
No, but I'm just interrupting you. I'm saying that life ultimately is subjective. And in a minute ago, you actually agreed with me that even logical arguments that are very
rational
are still taken subjectively. What I'm trying to say is, when we see any kind of argument, that the thing is, we're sitting in this crowd here, because many of the people listening to this, right, could be Sikh or not Sikh. And there's been situations where, for example, I've had debates with other people, where the argument that I'm making has seemed rational to those people. But the other, on the other side, you've had people that have said that my argument makes no sense.
Or maybe they're irrational.
Well, the question here is, I'm not here to judge that person rationally. What I'm saying is, as a general rule, you can't assume that just because one person sees something rationally, so I agree with that, but that becomes then a general rule for everybody.
No, I agree. I don't agree with that. Yeah,
ultimately, anything you present right now to say there's a rational argument for Islam will ultimately be subjective, because some people might not buy it.
No, you're missing the point, because people's experiences are not a yardstick to understand what is subjective, right?
Even people's understanding of logic isn't a yardstick.
Yeah, but you
because
did
some
it.
People don't understand it properly.
My example,
which makes sense to them, but it doesn't make sense.
I think you're misunderstanding my example. My example of understanding that me and you exist at the moment, but we may rationally disagree with panspermia or some other theory, whatever it is, yeah, goes to show that yes, you're right to a certain degree that rational argumentation can lead to subjectivity, or it can lead to
stem from subjectivity.
Yeah, it can. But my point is, there is some foundational truths I'm talking about. Just like you exist and I exist.
Earlier on, you came from the point of the prism.
And they awaken. They awaken.
You said the rational argument, the prism that you see the world through, is from Tawheed, the belief in one God.
Yeah,
both of us have that. Both of us have that, but we have a very different.
Well, it depends what you mean with Tawheed is, though, isn't it?
Well, we believe in the one creator.
So it depends what you mean by Tawheed.
Alright, well, why don't you enlighten me?
Well, what's your version of oneness?
No, oneness is, okay, well, is the only truth.
Oh, sorry, can I do this?
Yeah, yeah, man.
So one person is the one creator who created, sustains and destroys, only doer, only being of any power that gives its power to everything else, the being who is without fear, without hate, and the one that is just the one source of everything. Yeah? So the question
that's not our understanding of
what's talking to you.
Okay, but you uninterrupted though, please.
Sure,
yeah?
No,
okay, good. So we believe that the creator is the sole creator, sustainer and maintainer of everything that exists, right? That's one part of who he is, right? He also has names and attributes, right? For example, he's Al-Wudud, meaning the loving. Yeah. Coming from the Arabic word Wud, which means the loving that is given. He has an excessive boundless love, right? He's Al-Rahman, which means the intensely loving. It's a love that's boiling over. It's an immediate type of mercy, yeah? So these names and attributes, though, you cannot, for example, humanize them. What does that mean? You can't say God is the loving and I am the loving, right? Because you've humanized his names and attributes.
Is that in the philosophy of Tawheed?
Yeah.
That these characteristics of God cannot exist in a person?
Not in the absolute same way. Like, for example, God is boundless in his love, infinite and eternal in his love, for example.
Yeah. Right.
And he's the loving. I could be loving, but I can't be the loving. I'm not the divine, right?
But at a human level.
Yeah, of course,
you could be the most loving person in the world.
Absolutely.
But obviously you're restricted from the life you've got 18
I'm
years
contingent.
Or whatever. You can't love everybody because you don't know everybody.
I'm contingent.
You're living where you are,
right,
in London.
We're full of limitations, right? I'm contingent in my volume, size, space, experiences.
But in a limited way, a human being could become godlike then. What you're saying is agreed. But
we can be righteous, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. We want to manifest those names and attributes, not in a divine way, in a human way, right? So that's good.
So we can't agree so far.
I have finished. It's quite. That's why I said, don't interrupt, yeah? So we have his names and attributes that you can't deify, right? You can't deify me, right?
Yeah, you can.
And you can't, therefore you can't humanize his names and attributes by saying God is the loving and I am the lover. And at the same time, you can't deify a limited creature like myself. You can't say Hamza.
Is that part of Tawheed?
Yeah, Hamza's love.
Where is it written down?
First, let me describe and I'll give you everything, yeah?
Okay.
You can't say Hamza's love is like God's love, right? You can't deify me. That's deification. So there's no humanization, there's no deification. Does that make sense so far?
Okay.
Good. And then the other aspect is what you call his Tawheed of divinity, the oneness of his divinity. And this is maybe where we may disagree. But we would say that the divine, he is the one only worthy of worship. What does worship mean? To love God, to know God, to obey him, and to single all acts of worship to him alone. So what we're saying is that there's no intermediary in that worship in any shape or form, right? So grace comes only from God. Forgiveness comes only from God. Mercy comes only from God. There are no intermediaries from that point of view. If you want to connect with God, we don't say there is a wall or a book or Jesus. What we say is you connect straight with the divine. So this is what it means.
Could be a long time. I'm sure you can do an hour and
not. No, I mean, I just said we try and work on. Let's be nice. As, you've talked for a long time. Maybe 85% of what I've
talked.
70. You just need to let me finish, yeah? So the final part was, and listening with the intent to understand, right? Because you're just looking around and speaking. I'm trying to give you my full attention here. So the oneness of his divinity will be similar to all acts of worship to him alone. So those are the three main aspects of what you call Tawheed, affirming his oneness. Just to summarize, so creator, sustainer of the universe, you can't humanize his names and attributes, you can't deify a human being in terms of his names and attributes. He's the sole creator and he is one in his divinity, meaning only he deserves worship, which means to love God, to know God, to obey him, and to single all acts of worship to him alone.
Alright, so obviously we have a different conception.
Absolutely!
But not me and you do.
Yeah.
However, not all Muslims are meeting your view, do they?
Yeah, so what? Yeah, we talk to people.
What I'm trying to say is that many Muslims don't agree with your view that people, right, human beings, can't do grace. Well, I mean, if you look at the Sufi tradition of the Peers and stuff, people went to them and begged them for one session. They asked them.
The classical Sufis were never like this.
Right, but the point I'm trying to make is that this view. It's stressful.
It makes no difference what other people believe. You're talking to me.
Yeah, I'm talking to you, Hamza. Yeah. But the point
so
I'm trying to make
I think what I just showed was our lenses are different.
Yeah,
and you need to prove to me why your lenses are true.
Okay.
Because you've just agreed.
I don't need to prove that, it to you.
Okay, wait.
When we started, I said I'm
didn't,
not.
But didn't you agree that we view our experiences through certain lenses, right? We have experiences. We see them through a filter for certain lenses. You said, but we're both the same, bro. Tawheed.
Yeah,
I gave
you
the
lens from.
Let me finish. That's the discussion we should be talking about, right. Exactly. Okay. But once we do that...
Are you going to start to prove the Quran to me that it's objectively true and I have to believe in it? Is that what the point of the
argument
is? No,
I wasn't going to do that because okay. I do have
but
to
you're getting
on
it
at some
from
point.
The Quran and therefore you're getting it objectively
well,
Quran.
I believe...
So you start with the... So let me understand it. So I'm just going to summarize many of the arguments I've heard. Across the
no, don't do that here. Because that's like
it seems
that's
to start.
That's a red herring.
Okay,
I may not adopt those arguments.